This is a National Arts Center podcast.
Welcome to the Hexagon Studio. This is Marjolaine Fournier. I'm sitting here with Jean-Jacques Van Vlasler. And today we're going to talk about two subjects I love very much combined, Mozart and religion, and what the role of religion in Mozart's life. And I always find these topics fascinating because religion can be such a large subject, or a tiny one. Anyways, Jean-Jacques, you wanted to speak on this subject because our excuse, our pretext, is the Mozart Mass in D minor.
C minor.
Oh, what did I say? D minor. No, it's a huge difference.
Of course.
Three flats? Come on. So we'll talk about the three flats, I hope. Our excuse is that it will be played in Ottawa, but by the Orchestre Métropolitain de Montréal, under Yannick Nézet-Séguin. And so that was our excuse, but of course, any excuse is good to talk about Mozart. And I found, studying for this, or reading a little bit about this, that my view of Mozart, the man, has evolved quite a bit since our first visit together on his subject. He's much deeper than I thought, I think. So, the Mass in C minor.
Yes, and it's that Mass comes at a very precise moment in Mozart's life. You know, there is a whole period, which is the Salzburg period, which goes from his birth, obviously 1756, until 1781, when he decides to break with his lord, with the Prince Bishop Colloredo, who was the master ruler in Salzburg. And then Mozart will have the great period of Mozart. He has fought his way into a certain kind of liberty, that kind of liberty that will cost him very dearly also, but that is the Vienna period, and that will take 10 years exactly, 10 years and a half, 1781, 1791. And this Mass is composed in that very second period. Now, Mozart has been subjected to religion in that very beginning of his life, certainly, in the very beginning. And religion for him was something that had to do with hierarchy, with doctrines, with customs, with rules, with power. And this man is loves to break the rules. This man, by nature, loves to break the rules. And as a young kid, he has understood everything very soon in his life. He would take everything in, rework everything in function of that new period that existed and in which he was very lucky to live, which is the period of Enlightenment, Aufklärung. And this is a period in history that that is as fundamental in its change of society as what is happening, I think, today. And it goes very fast. Like today, it is going very fast. And we're trying to find our how fast and try where you know, keep some elements solid so that we don't are not brushed away by the new world. And the same thing is happening there. The Enlightenment. And what is Enlightenment? Well, Kant said it very clearly, philosopher Kant. He said to think by oneself. To think by oneself, you know, using your brains. So rationality is there. Suddenly people think for themselves. And by that they start asking questions. They start asking questions. They start to doubt. You know, they start to criticize. They're opening up their minds. People are opening their mind on the world around them. And so there is a creation, a renewed creation of what it is to be a human being. And there's the quest for perfectibility. And that perfectibility mm-hmm. goes together with that rational thought process. And it opens up on liberty, on autonomy, and on the liberty of conscience, and on the principle of happiness, and of equality. And of course, you have the three elements of the French Revolution, liberty, equality, and fraternity with it. And we'll talk about those three, because they're very much part of that period. And Mozart will be one of those people that is totally involved with all these elements. All these elements. And now, of course, when I was a little boy, you know, he just followed. He's a Roman Catholic upbringing, because he's in the south of the country, the south of, you know, Salzburg was a unit, a kind of independent unit, which lived next to Austria, next to the great empire of Joseph II. I like Joseph II very much as an emperor, because he was the only one that really tried to follow the new thought processes, and that's why he didn't go under like the French king Louis Capet went under, poor Louis Capet, you know. They in the other two countries, the Prussians, he said yes, I like Enlightenment very much, but I'll be the boss, you know. He stayed the boss. And then of course in Russia, the Russian empress bought the libraries of Diderot, bought the library of Voltaire. She loved the philosophers just to talk about it, but you know, she still ran Russia in a very unenlightened way. But Joseph II was much closer, and you know, and he had around him wonderful people that were all, of course, and we will talk about it a little bit later, the Freemasons. The Freemasonry was the kind of reunion of activities to implement, in fact, the new thought processes, that, you know, the opening up towards rationality and criticism and doubt.
So maybe this is the wrong time to ask, but was Mozart part of something? Did he catch the wave and rode it into the beach, or was he part of the creation of this movement? Do you know what I mean?
In fact, yes, I will answer that one. You know, the thought of the process of the Enlightenment is a fundamental and very creative humanism. Yes,
humanism,
and that brings forward the theories of Newton, and it brings forward the operas of Mozart and the Encyclopedia of Diderot. And I'm partially answering your question. Mozart will help. He's the one of my philosophy professors ever said, he's the praxis of Enlightenment. That means his life, his being, is really a model and a working model of what Enlightenment was about. And so Mozart lives it. Now, in the very beginning, This is not the case. This is not the case. Of course, right. he listens to his father. Power. They both work for the same prince bishop, which is again power. He himself is you know, is somebody that bypasses all these things. Mozart will bypass. You know, I always give this example. He takes a vulgar instrument at the time. A vulgar instrument was the clarinet. And he turns it into the most extraordinary, fascinating, poetical, human voice instrument.
Yes.
And I'm measuring my words. And so when he's a little boy, well, he has to write what he has to write, you know, and he creates things. The first opera he writes is about 10 years and a half for school. Die Schuldigkeit des Ersten Gebot, the first amendment and the power of that. And he makes a little play around that and music for it in school. And it has to do with the first Gebot, the first of the laws of the church. Then he writes at the same age his first Mass. And his first Mass, he's 11 years old, his first Mass will be the first of a series of 16 authentified, considered authentic masses that he composes before he goes to Vienna. So that first Salzburg period, there are 16 masses. And after the Salzburg period, when he frees himself, there will be two unfinished, religious works. Two masterworks, which is the C minor Mass we were talking about, and C minor Mass we will be hearing here in Ottawa, and the Requiem Mass, both unfinished.
Why do they call this? I mean, in my head I have answers, but why do they call it the Great C minor?
Because it is a masterwork,
right?
And it. He has written another C minor Mass before, much younger. So when there are two,
the little.
There is the little and the great. In Schubert's symphonies, we have the same thing with the great, which is the ninth symphony.
Yeah.
And there is another one before that in the same tonality and things like that. So that's the only way. That's only. But it's great because there are incredible moments in there.
Oh, yeah.
There are incredible moments. But first, I want to talk a little bit about that first period. You know, yes. When he is, you know, very nice answering what he has to do for the Prince Bishop. And so what he has to do is, amongst other things, write masses. And so he will write four masses when he's between his 12 and 13 years, between his 11 and 13th year, four masses. By the way, that very first Mass I was talking about will be played in front of the Imperial Court in Vienna on the 7th of December 1768. 1768, he's 12 years old, yes. Yeah. The 7th of December. That's interesting. 12 years old.
When you were 12.
What did you do?
Huh? I know.
Huh? What did you create? So afterwards he goes on these big tours with his father throughout Europe and goes essentially through Italy between his 13 and 17. You know, his father is, you know, presenting him and making money around that. But at the same time, his father is a very great pedagogue and he's teaching him all kinds of things and he's putting him in contact with all kinds of musical modes. And he learns a lot from his Italian trips. And when he comes back, between his 17th and his 19th years, he composes another four masses. And then he goes traveling again, and between his 19th and 21st year, another six masses. And then suddenly, you know, he's becoming a very young man and he's starting to revolt a little bit. And when that happens, he's 23 years old. So we're talking about 79. Mm-hmm. 1779 and 1781 which is the year he goes to Vienna, the breaking point. Well, he composes two masses, and one of those two masses is the crowning mass. It's a wonderful piece, and you know that when Joseph II died, and his brother took over, Leopold II took over. That's when Mozart was composing two operas at the same time, amongst which there were the Magic Flute. The crowning happened in Prague, and the Krönungsmesse, that's why it's called the Krönungsmass, because it was played for the crowning of Leopold II in 1791, in the right. summer of 1791. You know who conducted it?
Tell me.
Salieri. So Salieri conducted Mozart's Mass. So again, it's one of those things I want to say because so many lies because of the movie and so many mm-hmm. other false ideas about the relationship between Salieri and Mozart.
So this Mass, the crowning Mass, has a name, has a vocation, you know, a use. The Masses he wrote before, were they... were they ordered?
They were ordered. He had to produce a certain number of works.
So and that he didn't was part like of that. Work.
Mozart was not, and we will talk about that. You know, before composers had to write music for dances, for special dinners. Mozart yeah. still does that for the marriage of the daughter of the mayor of Salzburg. And for the church.
Right.
That was part of daily. But then you get, because of enlightenment, because of this reflection on oneself and the questions one is asking to the world and the schools that start to exist, the way society was moving also away from that medieval power, which was church and state and nobility, of course, that represented very often the state. You get into a period where composers have to ask themselves questions and say, well, why am I writing this? Where should music take us? Art becoming part of the questions one is asking oneself. And that's where Mozart is different from Haydn. Haydn is an extraordinary genius. I mean, and I use the word genius. He's the one who has a straightforward relationship with the outside world, and he's the one who invents forms, and plays around with those forms. But notwithstanding the humor that is into his music. It still is the form above the contents. Mozart will bring into music the me. I exist as an individual because rationality, because thinking oneself. So I exist. And so he will bring in this quest for transformation coming from yourself, and that's why composers at that time will have to dig deep into themselves to create new works. You know, in German, a composer is ein Tondichter. He's a poet of sound. That was invented around that time. It was not before. Before you were just a manufacturer of sound for dances, for functional things. And afterwards. And so Mozart, because it is Mozart, because he's most probably the first one that breaks open and teaches us to hear differently. And by listening to Mozart's works, and especially from that period on, from 1780 on, 1781 on, the works become great creativity, and are, for his piano concertos, are a diary of Mozart's moods, being the question. And his operas are about relationships, about you and me, about how do we go through this world, how are we free, and fühlen aus dem sehr high, how are we equal? Oh, the de figaro. How can we be fraternal? Well, you have the magic food. And so, I was talking about that crowning mass. In the crowning mass, there is a beautiful Agnus Dei for a soprano solo. It is the same melody. It's very, very close to the melody of the Countess in the beginning of the second act of the marriage of the Nozze di Figaro, the marriage of Figaro, if you want to. It's the same sound. What is Mozart doing in his religious work? So by the end, I was talking, those two last ones, mm-hmm. they're already almost becoming what we will have in the C minor mass after them. But C minor mass is still a different category, but you know, because he evolves so quickly, he goes so fast forward, Mozart, and he's refining and he goes deeper and deeper into himself. But that aria in the Agnus Dei in the crowning mass is in fact already a kind of opera. the church music has been bypassed by the quest of that soprano singing, and that will bring us, of course, that will bring us to the works that were circumstantial works, you know, circonstance, you know, that you had to do. Well, they're already being transformed from the inside. And so when he gets to Vienna, oh my God, when he gets to Vienna, he runs away from father and at the same time from the Colorado. So he's running away from organized religion. He's going away from it. But he hasn't read the philosophers. He hasn't read very much, but he knows everything straight away. He's one of these people that knows what it is. And of course, it's in that period, and he hears about it. And so the works will change. And that's why the two religious works that come later and unfinished ones are incredible works. The Mass in C minor, Kachel 4-7, and his Requiem Mass 10 years later of the Kachel 6-6.
So you're saying, if I understand correctly, you're saying that what Mozart does is, instead of, you know, when we play a Mass, the soprano becomes the ideal, it's the voice, it's not a woman singing. The tenor is a man singing. Sometimes a bass can be God singing, or something mm-hmm. like that. But mostly they're not human people. He brings, here I am, a human, singing my love, mm-hmm. Singing, mm-hmm. well, it's very, it's kind of obvious.
We're in that period, absolutely. But, we're in that period of transformation, so it's.
And so if you're listening to one of these masses, the humanity suddenly is part of the Mass, right?
And you know, in fact, and you and I have been talking about that when we were talking amongst us, Mozart is already there. Left and right, you have already enlightened works. You have already works that carry this incredible tenderness and this incredible quest for being oneself. Mm-hmm. And you know, of course, when he's younger, he writes the Exultate Jubilate, which has nothing to do with the church, but it's almost a grand air for soprano. And he writes the Ave Verum Corpus, of course, which is much later. The Ave Verum Corpus, which is Kachel 618, and in which we find all the influences of the Masonic world already, and the instruments of the Masonic world, which he will be using very much in his later works. And so I'm coming closer and closer to what Mozart's religion will be.
Yes.
And where the tendency which is going to be his, and of course this will be coming from that original fundamental first Masonic world in which God still existed. Most of the philosophers were deists, as they called it. They were deists, but God was the great architect of this world.
Mm.
And so he gets a second-rate role. He has built this world, and what are we doing here? And that's the big thing. And he's not a ruler anymore. He's an architect. And that's why all those elements of architecture and Mason, building the world, we will help him build that world that he has created. And that comes, of course, from the pantheistic thoughts process of this incredible philosopher called Baruch Spinoza, who lived in the Netherlands in the early 17th century. So there we go. I have to talk a little bit about the Mozart's time in Vienna, because he gets married to Constanza. He has to justify that, you know, his parents. What is that family about? And you know, and he says, "Oh my God, I'm living in this family," and he has been frolicking with several of the young ladies in the family. They're wonderful. I mean, they're so religious. Dad, be calm, you know, stay in Salzburg. Don't come and see the mother Cecilia, who likes her drinks. And then Aloysia, the second of the daughters, was the one who dropped him, in fact, between his trip to Paris when he came back from she was his absolute first great love, Aloysia, wonderful soprano, and of course he will use her in his operas. She will be all around. She had the most extraordinary voice. Constanza has a beautiful voice, but she is not Aloysia. And the oldest daughter, Johanna, will be the queen of the night. The family Weber is very much part of Mozart's life when he arrives in Vienna. And we're talking about that period. And he said, no, this is no problem. They're wonderful. And I have never prayed with as much ardor next to the one that Constanza, who will be his wife. Okay. He gets married to her. Without, in fact, the consent of the father. And he doesn't go back to Salzburg very quickly.
Wait, the consent of which father?
Of his father.
Ah.
His father. So, not really. Father is not very happy with that whole situation. But Mozart is then, you know, in 82. Well, that is, he's 25. And, you know, something has happened. His wife has been ill. And he promised that he would write a mass to thank God for her well-being. But that mass has been written partially, and meanwhile he's doing tons of other things as usual. Mozart, he's composing. You know, when he arrived in Vienna, he starts writing the Entführung aus dem Seraglio, and what is the first soprano? Well, her name is Constanza, not for nothing, and it's about liberty. And it's about tolerance by the other, by the Sultan. You know, mm-hmm. Tolerance comes from the Sultan. And so the Mozart elements are all getting together. And he writes this wonderful and very interesting letter on the 4th of January, 1783. I made this promise that, I started writing to his father, of course, and in my heart, and I really hope to keep it. Because when I made it, my wife was still suffering, and I was absolutely certain that I wanted to marry her as she was felt better. So, my wife before, and you know, I will marry her, and as soon as she feels better. So I'm just putting the attention to those few words. It was easy for me to promise this, and as reality of my wish, I have written a score of a mass, and which gives my best hope. So it will be a nice mass and things like that. But meanwhile, he's doing all kinds of other things, and so he goes with this partially finished mass. He goes to Salzburg to introduce his wife to his parents. And he will present his mass. He's not presenting it in the cathedral, but the cathedral, of course, is the power place of Colorado. I'm not gonna go there. and he goes to Saint Peter, and it's a wonderful church, a very darker church, a smaller church, and in which the role of the soprano will be sung by Constanza. But this mass is incomplete. He has finished the Kyrie, the Gloria, and when he gets to the Credo, at the Et Incarnatus, it's all the rest will be reconstructed from bits and pieces from the few notes he has written. So like the Sanctus is reconstructed, because only the woodwinds, the timpani, are of Mozart's writing. The Benedictus has been reconstructed from secondary sources. No Agnus Dei, Gracias, one measure, that's it. I mean, God. The Dona Nobis Pacem, there are two tryouts, one of three measures and one of eight measures. You know, I mean, that's it. He hasn't finished it. He hasn't finished it. Now, we have all kinds of reasons we can say for that unfinishing of it. And we'll get to that in a few seconds. But so the mass is being sung, and there is that, for me, the very important moment, which is the Et Incarnatus. It's the best part. It's the moment from which we can ask questions and say, my God, this is Mozart digging into himself to say something that will be difficult to say in a letter to his father. But that bypasses also the particular relationship between his father and himself, and perhaps also the particular relationship between his wife and himself. Our Dan, et incarnatus est de Spiritu Sancto ex Maria Virgine, e homo factus est. Maria Virgine, e homo factus est. How man is made, created. So, I don't think nobody has written anything more ravishing and profound of the mystery of incarnation, and Mozart talks here directly, I think, about his own creation, his own creativity, his own creation, through the spirit and the breath in a human body. And it's carried, wonderfully carried, by the voice of a soprano, Constanza. So Mozart is born from that incredible défi, you know, what you in English?
Challenge.
Challenge.
Yeah.
Of that melodic fugue.
Yeah.
And human life, what you feel from that is that human life is unique and infinitely precious. And it's carried by a voice of a woman that celebrates And that celebrates what the body is about, with all the finesses of the articulations of the skeleton, of the organs, your skin, your look, your hearing, your touching, your perfume, your savior. It's all there. It's suddenly human being, creation of human being, and it's supported and taken. She is the singer, is supported and taken up by the bassoons and by the clarinets. Oh my God, these are the instruments of the Freemasonry. And she floats on the waters, she floats, she organizes her voice, she plays, she cries, and she goes, she creates the genetic groundwater, and she gets through it. I mean, this is what it means. He doesn't stop enchanting us of this factus est, made, created, coming along. This is an incredible piece of music, and the factus is a real fetus, and it's a marvel. Somebody finally has been able to vocalize what that creation is about. And I must say, for the soprano, this is a big job. The soprano sings, that's a big job, because she has to understand that, and that she expresses a very great mystery. What are we? How do we come along? What is this about? And Mozart says it, et incarnatus est, and then he stops. He can't do it anymore. He can't say it anymore. Perhaps she had a miscarriage, and that's what he was talking about in the letter to his father. If you heard well the words I was using, I promised to, when I get married to her, but she, my little wife has not been well. So she could have had a miscarriage before her marriage, and that was that part. And he gets to that that moment in the work, and in that part of the credo, and he stops writing. The rest is put aside and finished. I mean, a few notes here, a few notes there, yeah. And then, and he will never write any credo anymore from March 1780 to his death. That means from his 24th to his 35th year. After having composed 12 credos between 12 and 24. And that's the whole difference. That's the whole difference of organized religion and masses written for organized religion, and what the creation of a human being is about. And that is fully in the line of what the Freemasonry thoughts are about at that time.
So I read that Constance said that church music was Mozart's favorite genre. I doubt it. Yeah, but still, he puts his best foot forward. From what
one always has to watch what the spouses, whatever they are, write about their partners. Don't believe what Alma Mahler wrote about Gustav. And she's a very nice young lady. She's the quiet one of all those of the four daughters. Well, I think the oldest one, Johanna, had to help the parents, had to help the mother. So she was about the outcast on the sidelines, notwithstanding her voice. Also, they all have voices. And these four girls.
This you spoke of et incarnatus est.
Yeah.
It's a virtuoso. I mean, I can't imagine. You have to be top-notch soprano to sing this.
Oh, yes, you have to be. And you have to understand that you're talking about the mystery.
The mystery, yeah, not just anything.
You know, one great soprano when she was teaching, Elizabeth Schwarzkopf, when she was teaching young singers to sing that part. Das muss gelassen sein. She said gelassen. That means you have to let yourself be carried into something that is beyond you.
True. So, you're not deciding. You're carried.
Well, she's carrying what the creation of human being is about, and you know, and nobody has ever. So, listening to this mass is going to the credo, and the incarnatus est. You know, and that's how you have to see that today. So I must say there are other reasons why he has not been able to finish it. I do think there is this profound reason of this unborn child.
Yes.
Which he carries in him, possibly. There are other reasons, because that is the time that he discovers Haydn's quartets. And in which he tries to write the Haydn quartets to please the one who is his spiritual father, musically. And as soon as Mozart finds something, he just drops, contrary to what Constanza said, he just drops church-related right. music. Yeah. And he has done that regularly throughout his career. So I don't fully agree what she says, but because the facts are that each time there are unfinished works or partially unfinished works, it's because he discovers new things.
Now, there's
and
one
new instruments.
Thing. Yeah. Oh, yes. Trombones.
And trombones.
Full on trombones.
You wanted to talk about that.
Well, you know, it was called The Great. Yes. And then, so I thought, why? And I couldn't figure it out. So I looked at the orchestration, you know, two flutes, two oboes, clarinets, bassoons, two horns. Then you have the baby trombone, which can be played by a trumpet, but then two more trombones. That's a lot.
That's a lot.
That's a lot. Yeah. And a timpani. So that's a nice, big, solid orchestra. Double chorus, which maybe I'm thinking maybe there's a little bit of response, like splitting a chorus is always interesting. Now, if she said that about religious music with Mozart, that's one thing. But I have a feeling from what I read of his letters here and there to his father, and it's funny, now I understand about the Freemasonry also. They almost never talk together in letters because that's top secret.
That's top secret.
I never figured it out until now. Mm-hmm. And this is why... Well, I would love to talk now about...
But I wanted to pull in something. You
yes.
have touched something very important, talking
Please.
About the trombones, and you were talking about the instruments. So, after the Colorado period, so this is the first mass he's composing after the Colorado period, and he's taking it back to Salzburg. So what does he do? He's going to do the contrary of what he does before. So he brings in those trombones.
Let's go. Full
and
tilt.
And he reinforces the choir, the
yes.
orchestrations. He attacks frontally the aesthetic problem which torments him since a certain number of months, which is the utilization of the fugue in a new expressive thought process. He wants to take the old old form of the fugue, and he wants to try to say something different or create new openings from the fugue on. And so, and why does he does all that? Because he has been very much enriched by the revelation of Johann Sebastian Bach, which was brought by Baron von Swieten, who was the librarian of Joseph II. And von Swieten was had great music knowledge, and he revealed Bach, Handel to Mozart.
There's a something that maybe you will disagree with, having heard this piece maybe more times than I have, but I heard, as you listen, as you play it, you feel that it's almost an homage also to past composers. And because I thought I heard little bits that sounded like Haydn, I thought I heard a quote of the Alleluia of Handel in the beginning. And I don't know. Ba-da-da-pop, ba-da-da-pop, ba-da-da-pop. That's not a mistake.
That's not a mistake. But they would use things that they had heard, you know, very easily at that time.
And the, so fugue could be, the fugue is also part and parcel of this homage, this
and I just told you that, you know, the string quartets by Haydn just impressed him so much, and that is the period he's going to write his string quartets in honor of Haydn.
Yes.
And that's why the mass went on sidelines. Mozart had already done that before when he wrote masses. He had always the same way of creating them, the same way of writing them. He started with the Kyrie, then the Gloria, then an Agnus Dei, and it's a very interesting thing. And what I said about the Credo, that he will not write any Credo anymore until his death in 1791. Do you know that Joseph Haydn, from 1780, which is the year he meets Mozart in Vienna, to 1796, because he will live much longer than this, doesn't compose a single mass. So this is the period where the masses are really will take a totally different view. Mozart doesn't write, you know, this is partially, and the Requiem is, well, it was a request, and you know, whatever we say about the Requiem, it's only a partially finished work also. So there are no masses anymore, in fact.
Interesting.
He writes different things. He writes masterwork after masterwork, those operas, and he writes those incredible Viennese piano concertos. 2, 3 at the same time. Wonderful chamber music in which all the notes or the combination of notes that represent the Freemasonry, the instruments of the Freemasonry, just float, open up in.
Let's just talk about it.
And
because,
let's for a few seconds come back to it, and that's opening up to the other and opening up. And Mozart writes lots of works. And I will reduce it to he writes cantatas, cantata, and which reflect in fact the ideas of Jean-Jacques Rousseau. You know, Cantata 619 is one of those. He will write many works for the Maurerfreude, for example, the joy of the Mason, das Lob der Freundschaft, the feast of friendship. Isn't that incredible? These are works that really talk about that knowing the other. You know, knowing the other, discovering, and of course, knowing the other, you discover yourself also. And so Mozart just composes one after the other. He writes a work which is the Köchel 623. It's the last finished work by Mozart. And it's created on the 18th of November, 1791. Now, 18th of November, you know, he dies in the first days of December.
Yeah.
And he's fine. He will sing the tenor role in that song, melody, for a group of singers and a few instruments behind it. And it's called Let's Hold Hands. And I would love, I think everything will be said from the text of this work. And Mozart sings it on the 19th of November, 1791.
So you say he can sing 2 weeks, he's singing,
well, he was singing
2 weeks
yes.
before he dies.
It came very quickly. It came very, very quickly. And the one who looked after him, in fact, was the youngest daughter, who never got married. She got married after Mozart's death. So she was the one who was very close to him, and she was. I'm just mentioning this because I mentioned the other sisters.
Yes.
And here is this text of Lass uns mit geschlungen Hände. Let's clasp our hands. Let's hold our hands, my brethren, brothers, and finished his work in the soundburst of our joy. And as our bond surrounds the sacred place, let us embrace the entire terrestrial globe, universality. Never forget what Haydn said about his own music, because he was very much part of that time, Haydn. And he said, you know, my music is the first music that everybody will understand. Universality, it's there. It's there, it has to go in, and we still understand, everybody, whatever, from whatever background you come. One understands Mozart, one understands Beethoven, one understands Haydn. It was an incredible period, of course. So let us embrace the entire terrestrial globe, the world. Let's, through our joyous singing, recognize fully our Creator. Of course, the Creator is there. You know, even Spinoza agreed that there was a Creator. But for Spinoza, it was the world. It was nature. With something, an organization behind it, but, you know, it was nature. And by the way, that's why Spinoza is coming up back these days very much. Because yes. Ecology, environment, those philosophers were absolutely ahead of their time and created a world in which, you know, that kind of brotherhood was the ultimate goal. So recognize fully our Creator, whose total power joins us. That means we are part of that power. So it's not a power that crushes us, it's a power that opens us up with him.
That's a vast difference.
Isn't it yes. A vast difference? The consecration is accomplished. Let our work, which our hearts have undertaken, be also accomplished. And so the heart is coming in. And the heart is, of course, the me, very much so. And that's why the 19th century is born also. Romanticism is born. And those that know very well the magic flute, there is a moment in it with the two soldiers that, you know, when the two heroes have to go through the fire and the water. This is the beginning of romantic music. If Mozart would have lived, he would have created very different music, most probably 10 years later. Mm-hmm. 10 years later. So to venerate or to revere virtue and humanity. It's come to virtue, humanity. To learn love of oneself and of the other. Let that be always our first duty. Then, and only then, in the Orient and in the West, in the Occident, but also in the South and in the North, light, enlightenment will stream down. This is the last completed work by Mozart. And I always say, if one listens to the Requiem Mass, one has to listen through the Requiem Mass, this text I just read for you. And so Mozart's spirituality had to do with transcendence, but the transcendence that comes from within us. And that is not imposed on us. Difference between the tradition, organized religion in relation with power, and that transcendence we find in ourselves.
Always from within. Oh, Jean-Jacques.
So I think that Mass is a cornerstone, even if it's not finished. And in that cornerstone, there is the Et Incarnatus Est. It's about Mozart saying, yes, I'm free and I can talk about it now. I can talk about my creation. I have my own creation, and my creation is, and I know what it is. And he has taught us to listen differently to music. He is a real, real model of what the Enlightenment, the Aufklärung, is about.
Yeah, you answered perfectly that question. I would love to ask you all my 5 million other questions. Mm-hmm. As always, we have to stop. It was a pleasure talking with you. I'm looking forward to our next visit. I think it will be maybe Nielsen.
Yes, and the Nordic composer.
Another, it's very exciting because it's, I think we never approached his music before.
No.
And that will be a lot of fun, I think, to prepare for and to visit with you and hear what you have to say. Thank you so much, Jean-Jacques.
You're very welcome.
This has been a National Arts Center podcast. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Centre.